Welcome back to our final session for the first day and for our second and final keynote for the first day. We have a pleasure of hosting Dave here. He is on a good way to becoming a HeapCon regular, which would be very nice. Enjoy this last session. And of course, I will just once again remind you that we have some donation boxes just outside and all around the place, really. It's a really good cause. So please make sure to donate something. If you are sharing some pictures from the conference, use hashtag HeapCon2022 or hashtag TechUnites, which is our motto. And I hope that you indeed feel united by tech today. Thanks, Dave.
Thank you. Just to say, if anybody wants to interrupt, ask a question or have an argument, feel free. I'm happy to adjust what I do as I go along. If I start to speak too quickly, my apologies. I'm Welsh, I'm not English. That's becoming increasingly important to emphasize given what's happened to the English government. But Welsh is spoken about 30% faster than the English, so we tend to do that, all right? So feel free to interrupt. I thought I'd start with this, and there is actually a sort of tangential link back into the opening keynote. It was a real pleasure to hear somebody argue for the primacy of data sciences over algorithms. I worked for 10 years of my life in DARPA on counterterrorism, working on how do we create better training data sets rather than how do we create better algorithms. And that sort of stuff has been around for two or three decades, so it's good to see it coming back to prominence. And I'm also going to emphasize in this presentation the value of process rather than personality. That's kind of like what this slide is about, which I like to show at various OD and Agile conferences. There's this rather naive belief that if everybody had the right mindset, somehow or other wonderfully, the world would be a better place. And the reality is it actually makes very little difference on an individual level. If you actually want scalable behavior in human systems, you need to have processes which engender the right behavior, rather than assuming behavior will engender the processes. That's kind of like the wrong way around. So I want to emphasize that. The core of this presentation is around a guidebook which I produced jointly with the European Union a year ago now, a joint publication of my research center in the European Commission on how to manage in complexity in a crisis. It was written in the context of COVID, but it has much wider implications. You can actually, I'll give you a QR code towards the end. You can actually download this for free. I don't recommend it, printing it off unless somebody else is paying for the ink cartridges. You can also get a physical hard copy sent to you for the cost of postage. It's a free even outside the European Union. So that's going to be the theme. But I want to start with some general comments about the approach I've been developing over the last 30 years. And also some pleas within the software community. I started my life coding actually at school when my first ever program was written over a 250 baud acoustic coupler. You guys don't know how hard it was in those days to fake my physics practicals. I just couldn't stand doing practical physics. It was a waste of time. Somebody else had already done the experiments and computers could generate tables for you. So that was actually quite useful. And the headmaster in our school also made us learn how to use a punch card machine because he said it would give us a job for life. The modern equivalent is teaching Java code to kids in schools. By the time they graduate, it will be so out of date, it's unbelievable. We really need to be teaching them design skills and anthropology and things about human systems and human people. The tech side is easy to pick up. The people side takes a lot longer. But from that, I moved into decision support systems. I built the systems for people like Guinness PLC. I've built three software businesses now. Two within a company, my latest for myself, when I left IBM. And in all of those cases, one of the things we've been focusing on is application software rather than project software. That's my background. And in application software, you build for needs that people haven't yet articulated. The secret of building good applications is to build something which allows people to do things that they haven't asked for. Okay? Now, I'm going to emphasize that because at the moment, the whole software industry is heavily geared towards a manufacturing approach. The assumption is somehow or other magically users know what they want, they feed it into a backlog, we execute it, and they should all be really happy. I say I've been in software development most of my life. Users never want what you prove they can ask for when you deliver it, because of course when you deliver it, they realize they could have asked for something different. There's also a tendency in the software community who don't really like users, if we're all honest about it, to try and make them appoint one of their number to represent them, and we only want to meet them at the start and the end of a project, and would they please stay away in between it? I'm going to talk in a minute or two about new techniques and methods we've been developing to deeply entangle users, not at a representative level, but an operational level with the capabilities of code, and work we're currently doing to train users to actually explain things better to IT people. Just to tell you now, it's a lot easier to train users to talk to IT people than train IT people to understand users. So I'm going down the easier pathway. I'll give you the cognitive neuroscience behind that if you want it later. So one of the images I've put up here is actually a potter. And I want to try and make the argument that software needs to become a craft industry rather than a manufacturing process. Because in a craft, you have various levels of skill, and experience is vital. It's not just that you go on a two-day course, do an open book exam, and get a certificate to say you're the master of something. Yeah, that really isn't what it's about. Some human knowledge we know takes 4 or 5 years for the body and brain to co-evolve to the point where you can be said you know things, and that applies to software development as well. So in the craft industry, we have the mechanical ability, the craft, what Aristotle called pronesis, practical wisdom. But we also have theoretical knowledge of the nature of clay, the nature of the wheel, the nature of dynamics, what Aristotle called sophia. And you need both. You need practical wisdom and theoretical wisdom, and the two need to interoperate. It's not just the most misused word in the Agile community is empirical. You can tell they've never done philosophy. What they mean by empirical is what worked for me the last time I did it, and I really don't want to bother to think about whether it will work the next time or not. That's generally what empirical means. Yeah. So in the craft industry, we need to sort of think differently. And the process we approach is, the name for it is naturalizing sense making. Sense making, which has a hyphen, sorry, these things matter to those of us in academic environments. If it has a hyphen, it's a verb. If it's sense making is a single word, it's a noun. And for me, sense making is very dynamic. It's much more a verb in that sense. It means, how do I make sense of the world so that I can act in it? Which means, how do I know what sort of actions I can take on the basis of the knowledge I actually have? Again, that's coming back to the opening keynote. The data analytics part of this is actually really important. Naturalizing means to base what you do in the natural sciences. Sorry, my background is theoretical physics and philosophy. It was an indulgence when I did it, but it's proved quite useful since. But it means I have a physicist's despair of social scientists because they never have enough data to form any valid conclusion anyway. But there's a whole body of stuff that we know about the way human beings make decisions, about the way systems operate, which has been subject to peer review, which has been subject to third-party experimental validation, which has been generated by more than one person, and therefore that we can rely on. That also, by the way, makes me deeply suspicious of anything coming from psychology, because if you don't know it, in psychology over the last few decades, people have been trying to replicate the classic experiments and discovering they can't replicate them. They were kind of like one-time things, but they don't replicate. So I want to come back really more to the cognitive sciences, less psychology, in terms of the way we work on this. And you'll see that come through in a minute. So that's kind of like important. And as I say, the idea is to move away from this manufacturing framing of problems. Virtually every agile method has come from manufacturing, which is a closed system. All right, and the problem is we're dealing with services which are an open system. So we actually got to rethink some of these. Particularly, I'm going to emphasize what goes into the backlog. Very few agile methods focus on user requirements capture, or they just assume it can be done or made explicit, or they assume that user stories then linked with scoring systems can produce the right result. And I mean, even Ron Jeffries has thrown that idea out now with some support from me and others. So I think, you know, I really want to emphasize this different way of thinking. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run you through 6 basic things from natural science. all of which are relevant, none of which I expect you to fully understand first up, some of which I don't fully understand yet. There's, you know, cognitive neuroscience is really exciting at the moment, so is biology, in terms of the way it works. But they give us indications of what we can work on. The first is this. This is from a famous body of experiments. If you present a group of radiologists a batch of x-rays and you ask them to look for anomalies, and on the final x-ray you put a picture of a gorilla, which is 48 times the size of a cancer nodule, on average 83% of radiologists will not see it, even though their eyes physically scan it. Yet we do not see what we do not expect to see. And you can't train yourself not to do this. The reason for this is the most you scan of available data is between 3 and 5%, and 5% means you're really concentrating. That's all you'll see. That then triggers a series of memories, both cognitive, physical, and social. I'll come back to that in a minute. It's not just cognitive. Those memories, you do something called conceptual blending. You blend them together, and you do a first fit pattern match, not a best fit pattern match. So the minute you get a pattern which seems to work, you use it. Now you can see why, because if you think about the early hominoids on the savannas of Africa, something large and yellow with very sharp teeth runs towards you at high speed. Do you want to autistically scan all available data, look up a catalogue of the flora and fauna of the African veldt, and having identified lion, look up best practice case studies in how to avoid lions? By that time, the only document of any use to you will be the Book of Jonah from the Old Testament, which is the only example I've found of an escape manual from the digestive tract of a large carnivore written by a purported survivor. Yeah. We evolved to make decisions very, very quickly based on a partial data scan, privileging our most recent individual and social experiences. And that's how you all make decisions. And so you can see now why I want to get rid of systems analysts. Because they only hear what they expect to hear. If you conduct more than two interviews, this will really scare you now. You conduct more than two interviews, you form a subconscious hypothesis based on that, and you only pay attention to things that match that thereafter. Klein, myself, and others in this field now refuse to use the word bias. Yeah, they're not biases, they're heuristics. Overall, they work well for the species. They've evolved because actually, at a species level, they make a lot of sense. In individual cases, they may not. So once you recognize this, you design with the biases rather than trying to remove them. That's what a naturalistic approach is. This is really realist and it's really materialist in terms of the way we work. It also leads into this phrase I'll use later called finding the 17%. How do you find the people who've seen a gorilla before they talk to the people who haven't? Because if they talk to people who haven't, they'll stop believing that they saw it. And again, that's a human phenomenon. Second one is the role of stories. This is actually a picture from work we were doing on genital mutilation in Africa. One of the big things we've done over the years is focus on making people ethnographers to their own condition and removing outsiders. Pioneering programs with the UN, for example, in Hungary, working with Roma, where we use Roma kids to act as ethnographers to Roma adults without anybody from outside that community involved. And that sort of work moves into requirements capture and a whole body of other areas. But there's some key things to understand about story. How many people have got children? Okay, yeah, some of you, sorry, I'm getting old now, some of you are young enough to still remember when adults told you stories, all right? But you all tell stories, yeah? Do you tell them stories about how Janet and John stayed at home, achieved the family velocity targets, and managed the KPIs and the objectives? Anybody do that? Or no, all fairy stories tell stories about children who go into the woods against mummy and daddy's advice, meet witches and, you know, warlocks and wolves and God knows what else. Yeah, we have a happy ending because we want them to sleep at night, but we leave it as long as possible and we try and scare the living daylights out of the little buggers in the bit between. Now, that is true of all storytelling traditions. In your own company, what stories spread fastest? Stories of failure or stories of success? It's stories of failure, isn't it? We actually evolved as malicious gossips. Because actually, avoidance of failure is a more successful strategy than imitation of success. And human beings pay more attention to failure than they do to success because we learn more from it. That means we actually use negative stories rather than positive statements. If you want to create a sense of direction or a mission or purpose, we don't produce a set of anodyne platitudes on a flip chart and spend a lot of money with consultants trying to communicate them better. What we do is we agree stories about what we don't want to be, which creates some boundaries and a common reference point, and that leaves open discovery of new pathways, but within boundaries. We build worst practice systems for companies. If you actually go into software development, you don't want to learn how other people got it right. It's much more useful to get all the stories of how other people got it wrong. And so why don't we build systems which reflect that in terms of the way we work? So that's the role of narrative. And then we get complexity science. Complexity is kind of like the big thing, and it is science. Please don't confuse it with systems thinking, all right? They have some overlaps, but they're very different roots. Complexity is the science of systems which are deeply entangled. Yeah, in fact, that's going back to the original Latin Greek roots. Complicated means folded. I can fold something and I can unfold it. It's not changed. Complex means entangled. Once things are entangled, you can't break them up again. It's just not possible, not without damage. Yeah? So everything is entangled with everything else. And what that actually means, and I'm not going to go into this in a huge amount of depth, this is what the Kinevin framework is all about, is that basically it means I can't predict, yeah, any future state with any accuracy. To put it brutally, a complex adaptive system has no linear material causality. There is no cause and effect link, right? Or at least none which repeats. We only see them by accident. Yeah? The best way I've learned to describe this, and this, you can see my physics background coming out now, if you think about, you know, if you have a flat surface, which for the pedantic amongst you has a high coefficient of resistance. Now, there are engineers in this audience, so I need to get that out of the way up front. Yeah, and around that flat surface, you have electromagnets, which can change in polarity and strength. Right? Some of those I can change. Some of them have been changed by people I'm aware of. Others are just changing. I don't know whether it's accidental or whether somebody's doing it. Everybody got that picture? And in the middle of the flat surface, there are lots of cast iron disks, some of which are standalone, some of which are connected to the others by elastic bands, some by light chains and so on. Now, if all of the magnets keep the same polarity and the same strength, then basically the disks form a stable pattern. If I change one of the magnets, I can predict the change. If I change two of the magnets, I can predict the change. If I change three of the magnets, forget it. I can no longer predict it. Right? Now, these in complexity are called modulators. So a complex adaptive system is modulated. It doesn't have causality. And of course, if you think about it, and this is a key message I'm going to come on to in a minute, as long as I can see what's happening to the disks in real time, I can make small changes to the magnets I control to influence the outcome. And what really matters in a complex system is understanding and managing those modulators and getting real-time feedback loops so you can make small changes early rather than trying to predict the future. In fact, one of the big things we now do in complexity theory is we focus on describing the present rather than creating scenarios about the future. In fact, in a complex world, scenario planning is really very dangerous because you end up believing you've covered the range of possibilities by your scenarios, and therefore you may actually miss things that you would otherwise not, you're not expecting to see. It augments that bias type problem I mentioned about earlier. So complexity requires us to understand what things are having an impact on the system, because a complex adaptive system I can measure its dispositional state. I'll show you an example of that in a minute, but there aren't cause and effect relationships. And of course, in a dispositional state, what matters is I can influence the direction. I'll make a general statement now. I'm not going to do this. This is the really big thing I'm working on at the moment, which is called estuarine mapping, which is going to be big. It's bigger than Kinevin already as in terms of early adopters. And what that does, it says you don't try and achieve an outcome. You change the map and then change the energy gradients. So the things you want are more likely to happen because they consume less energy. Now, if you want to actually achieve something which requires high energy, it's probably not going to happen anyway. To put it very simply, if the energy cost of virtue is higher than the energy cost of sin, then people will sin. So again, we're all talking about now trying to change the dispositional state so that we can make things work in the right way. And this, by the way, is one of the key issues about software design now. You're not designing an individual program. You're designing an ecosystem which makes some things easier and some things harder. And our design is currently always focused on individual components or individual processes. It's not really focused on the ecosystem as a whole, and that's one of the big changes. Next one up. If you don't know it, abduction is really important. There are three types of logic: deductive, inductive, abductive. Deductive is if A, then B. Inductive is all the cases of A have B associated. Abductive is sometimes known as the logic of hunches. What's the most plausible connection between apparently unconnected things? If you have any dyslexics in your company, by the way, and there aren't many in IT, I'm one of them, this is what dyslexics do all the time. We constantly make connections and nobody else can see why we made them, and we can't understand why they can't see it. Yeah, and that's actually why we can't spell. I mean, for God's sake, all the letters are there. Why are you worried about the sequence? It's irrelevant, all right? That's a dyslexic thinking. So abductive logic is really important because it's where innovation comes from. And it's one of the things that we now start to work on is how do we entangle things in such a way that you create very small, sudden, unexpected side effects. If you look at the whole of the drug development industry, where I do a lot of work, is entirely dependent on noticing side effects. The same is true if you look at it. The great software platforms, none of them are doing what they were originally designed for. It's just they designed an ecosystem and small things magnified and the whole system changed. Right? So kind of like we know some of this stuff, we just don't use it. And abduction is a key principle, and how you actually identify that is vital. And just so you know, it turns out that art came before language in human evolution. Yeah, our language evolved from abstraction, from art and from music. And it turns out the value of that is what art does is it disconnects us from the physical, so we see novel patterns. So an excessive focus on STEM education is really dangerous for society. Yeah, you need to enjoy music, you need to enjoy art, you need to enjoy all sorts of things, because that's the way you create the disconnect and you make novel connections. So we know that abduction and aesthetics are quite closely linked in terms of the way they work. The next one is acceptation. This is the famous case in biology. Feathers evolved in evolved in dinosaurs for sexual display and maybe warmth. Yeah, they're very colorful if you look at the discoveries in northern China. And a very small breed of dinosaur developed skin flaps under its forelimbs. So it could better display those feathers for, you know, to attract a mate. But because those dinosaurs were more prey than they were predators, they had to run very quickly, and when they ran very quickly, they put their forelimbs out, and guess what? They started to glide. So flight was an accident. If dinosaurs had thrown themselves off cliffs in the hope of evolving feathers before they hit the ground, it probably wouldn't have been a good strategy. If you don't know it, digits evolved in the oceans before fish came on the land. Yeah, if you look at the history of evolution, a trait which evolves for one function under conditions of stress accepts, it doesn't adapt for something completely different. Yeah, the cerebellum at the base of your brain evolved in the higher apes to do fine-grained manipulations of muscles in fingers. It then accepts in humans to manage grammar in language. The huge sophistication of grammar is too much to evolve in a linear way. It requires a non-linear repurposing. If you think that isn't relevant, look at how IBM dominated the computer industry. It was the worldwide market leader in punch card control machines to handle industrial machines. It has spent 50 years working out all the manuals and the technical stuff and got the experience. So they could move that sideways for computer programming, and they dominated for the next 50 years. Apple, if you haven't seen it, are supreme at exaptive innovation. They take technologies evolved for one function, and they find a way to use them for something different. Yet microwave ovens came because somebody noticed the significance of a chocolate bar melting in their pocket, put a metal box around the magneto of the radar machine they were maintaining, and we got microwave ovens. Yeah, there's a whole principle now we're starting to develop in terms of software architecture, which goes back to some of the original object orientation stuff, which is not the same thing as microservices. Please don't confuse the two. Yeah, where actually you design systems so that they can interact in such a way that they will produce stable novelties. Again, you're not designing for a purpose. You're designing from an ecosystem which can evolve very quickly. Right? And that requires a whole concept of granularity and scaling, which we can do and we know how to do it, but it's something we need to do some more work on. So that's a key language to get. And the final one, this is the whole danger that we've got of what's a Cartesian model of how human beings make decisions. People talk about, they're forever talking about the brain. You get this total nonsense that there's a left brain and a right brain, one of which is logical and one of which is emotional. I mean, that's been disproved. It was never proved. It's just completely wrong, but we love it. But then you can have pictures and say, is it a rabbit or is it a beak or whatever it is, all right? And you go with that. The reality is, yes, there are differences in the brain. Yeah? But for example, if you take the famous thinking fast, thinking slow. Why an economist is ever given a Nobel Prize for something to do with cognitive neuroscience, I don't know. We knew everything he discovered 10 years before he started that research. It's called autonomic and novelty receptive processing, and it's not two sides of the brain. Yeah, it's actually a complex interaction between the body and the brain and its social environment. When you pull your hand away from a hot plate, your brain fires after the event. Not because you don't have free will, but it's just double-checking whether the automatic response was right this time or not, in case it needs to correct. And just to say, one of the things you desperately need to do for innovation is increase cognitive load. Because as long as it works, you don't think differently. Yeah, the novelty-receptive aspect of the brain only clips in if the autonomic responses start to fail consistently. So one of the things to do, you have to do for innovate, is put people in a position where they can't go down the previous pathways. And then this classic mistake, which you see all the way through systems thinking, they observe a desirable property. You know, innovative people are creative. Well, yeah, that's true. So let's run creativity programs and create childhood playpens for adults with pretty colored sofas and toys. Yeah, creativity arises as a result of the pressure which drives the innovation. It's an emergent property. It has no causal agency whatsoever. Yet it's an emergent property of a process. Right? We now know that actually consciousness is a distributed function of the brain, the body, and critically, its social engagements. This is Andy Clark's work on scaffolding. We use narrative in society as effectively a proxy for our own brain processing. Makes sense if you think about it. The common stories of the society in which you grow up actually fundamentally influence the way you perceive data. So we need to start to realize consciousness is a distributed function. And the way people interact with computers therefore needs to be physical and social as well as cognitive. It's why things like Meta will never work, or if they do work, will be reduced as humans in consequence. If you don't know it, pheromones are key to human beings deciding whether they trust each other or not. Anybody seen pheromone transmission in a Zoom call? Yeah, we're losing capacity because actually communication is much more sophisticated than we think. So please break the sort of cognitive framing. And that means words like mental models, which was a cute concept in the 1980s, are just a complete nonsense. There are no mental models to which you filter data. And the whole concept of mindset, and sorry, I'm really apologizing in the Agile community, there is no such thing as a mindset. Yeah, there just isn't, right? I mean, it's very convenient. I ran this big Agile program and I spent, you know, millions of dollars on SAFe and I've got everybody certified and it hasn't worked. Oh, you didn't have the right mindset. It's your fault. Yeah? Basically, humans are fundamentally influenced by their physical environment and their social interactions far more than by their own cognitive preferences. Yeah, we're social creatures and we evolved as such. Changing how people connect is both more effective and more ethical than trying to change how they think. Right? Now, again, I can go into any of this in more detail if anybody wants, but those were the sort of six basic things I wanted to come across on. So that leads us into the You Feel Guide. That talks about five fundamental things you need to do to create a resilient organization. Now, many, many years ago for my sins, actually about 50 years ago, I took Johari Windows and I created a 3x3 matrix which went known, unknown, unknowable in terms of the nature of the system, and known, unknown, unknowable in terms of our capability to know it. I actually presented that in the Pentagon where I was working for DARPA, and then it got misused and I couldn't use it again for 20 years. I'm trying to resurrect it now. But what he actually forgot was the unknowable element. And there are two massive dangers in organizations. One is the unknown unknowables. The things that we don't know that we actually can't know until they happen anyway. And people found that difficult. But after COVID, okay, with retrospective coherence, you said we should have known. The reality is we all know that it was completely unexpected in intensity and anything else. Oh, and by the way, it's not the worst outbreak we're going to get in my lifetime, and I'm 68. There's stuff hatching out in the Siberian tundra at the moment, which is bacterial, not viral, to which we got no natural resistance. And if you look at the history, bacterial plagues have a bigger effect on humans than viral plagues. Yeah, and we have to get society ready for that because it's coming soon, yeah, along with other effects of global warming. But coming back to the point here, right? I shouldn't go down these little sidelines. Yeah. And I'm sorry, I have to say I'm very depressing think tank, so I want to share the despair so that you all know how bad it is, right? Either way, the point I'm trying to make is that unknowability is key. And what that means, we've got to build systems which actually can handle threat that we are not yet aware of. And we're not designing that way. We're assuming we can anticipate all the things that it has to work for. We've got to start designing systems which are people and software and tools and all that sort of stuff together, which can handle as yet unanticipated threats. And the other main danger are the unknown knowns. The things we know in the organization but aren't known to the decision maker. And I'm going to talk in a minute about the new work we're doing on distributed decision making, by which we engage the whole of the workforce in situational assessment, and by the way, which we distribute, but we don't delegate decision-making into that workforce. Right? And that's a key principle. In fact, that's kind of like the first one up. So what the EU Field Guide talks about in terms of leadership is the main role of leadership is actually to coordinate. I mean, I see a lot of Agile presentations where they keep blaming C-level or bad leadership or lack of direction. I've been C-level, all right? If you're lucky, you get 3 minutes to make a decision with five groups of people who know more about the subject than you present in slide sets. Do not blame C-level, all right? They're under damn sight more pressure. Yeah, the way you feed data to them is actually really important, yeah? And the reality is most of your time, as you get more and more promoted, you only meet angrier and angrier customers. I mean, the guys at the happy customers are kept down there, right? The bad customers come up pretty damn fast. And actually, realistically, the fewer actual decisions you make. So your role is more coordination, stimulation, reinforcement, disruption. And it takes a bit of time for people to learn that. The only time it's different is in a real crisis where you have to make decisive decisions not to solve the problem, but to increase the options available for other people to come up with a solution. If you look at what happened during COVID, Jessica, I think New Zealand is planning to export some prime ministers. Yeah? Basically, she locked down the country the minute she realized it might be necessary. She broke the law to do it. It gave them far more options downstream than in continental Europe or Britain, where we waited till we had no alternative. So decisive actions to increase options is a key leadership skill. And again, that's something we now provide training in. But the other thing is distributed decision making. Now, let me give an example on this. When I was running a software business in a company called Data Sciences, which got taken over by IBM, I got called into the managing director's office. And he said, you're going to write the ISO 9001 manual. Anybody written an ISO 9001 manual? Okay, it's quality control. And I looked at him and said, look, the last time I was in this office, you were screaming at me for breaking the rules. And I now only got away with it because I'm making so much profit, you don't fire me, right? There's the story about that I'll tell you over a beer later, right? Naive users are wonderful if you're prepared to play the game. And he said, poachers make the best gamekeepers. Need to check that translates. Thieves make the best policemen. Yeah? So I decided, if he was starting to think about me like that, I needed to cooperate. He said, if you write it, we've got a chance of getting through the audit. If I give it to quality control, it will end up as a 5-volume manual with a 3-week training course, and I'll have to double the size of the quality department to get us through the process. So either way, I was still coding then, so I agreed to do it. And I always like do case statements, which tells you my generation. So I wrote this series of do case statements, for each department. If this happens, we do this. If this happens, we do this. If this happens and you have this qualification, you can do this or this or this. That's the clear and complicated domains of Kinevin, by the way, but I didn't know about it then. If anything else happens, you assemble people from these three roles with these three backgrounds. They make a decision, they minute it, and that's it. And they have authority to do it. Right? So that was understanding complexity. I can't predict what the right thing is. I can't afford to let one person make the decision. So we bring people together from different backgrounds and authorize them to make the decision, provided they're transparent about it and they make it quickly. Right? That got us through it. We also had a manual, so I'm very pragmatic about this. We knew that some general managers couldn't be trusted to tell the truth in the way that quality inspectors would understand it. It's not that they lied, but the way they told the truth tended to cause problems. So we had a list of people with an emergency email list. And if a quality inspector arrived, and they arrived at random, security were instructed to challenge their ID to give us 10 minutes to evacuate said general managers from the site. So they nominated deputies who were trained how to answer questions, rather than do the job, could deal with it, right? I highly commend that approach to quality controls if you need to do it. Now, we separately extended that in safety. In companies like Boeing, you can break any rule provided three engineers from completely different backgrounds with different perspectives agree you can break the rule and agree what you should do. That made a massive difference to accidents because sometimes you have to break the rules. We're now doing that in communities. Young person with people from their grandparents' generation with somebody from local government, if the three agree on something, they can spend up to so much money without further reference. Yeah? So that's called distributed decision making. So you're not focusing on individuals, you're focusing on processes between linked groups of people where you've got transparency, but you can make real decisions in the field. We're just about to implement this in one of the big pharma companies, and we've built in a 12-hour review process. So you minute what you're going to do, it's transparent and visible to senior management. If they don't object within 12 hours, you get the authority to do it. Now, if you look at what we're doing there, we're not saying, give us the authority, let us be self-organizing teams. No C-level person is going to trust you to do that because the IT community hasn't got a very good reputation. All right? Yeah, you have to have a good reputation to be trusted, and you ain't got one. And I speak as one of us, all right, in that sense. This is a process which reduces risk because it delegates it into a process, not an individual. And by the way, people acting in roles actually are more prepared to confess failure than people talking as individuals. Yeah, that's been shown by Vike and others in a whole body of research. So that's kind of like action number one. Action number two, you need to build informal networks. I've double-checked this with a whole bunch of executives. What really mattered during COVID was who you knew from previous working together, not the formal system. So when the crisis hits, you fall back on trust, Trust is informal networks. We now have methods like entangled trios or social network simulation, which within 18 months can have everybody in the organization at all levels within 2 phone calls of everybody else. Right? Because what you want is a distributed informal network. It's rather like the fungal roots that connect tree roots. Without that, it's not healthy. And if you look at it, the Singapore government has a very healthy ecosystem because all of its staff actually do national service together. Yeah? Whereas the British government, they all go to the same 3 elite schools and the same 2 elite universities, so it's not distributed. So actually consciously building informal networks is key. And one of the ones we're now doing is user trained to talk to IT people with young bright programmer with systems architect. So when we wanted to use a requirement, we show 10 trios like that at a problem for 3 months and see what they come up with and synthesize the results. Now it has multiple benefits. One is we find the 17%. The other is we start to link and connect people across boundaries which don't normally exist. And we build those informal connectivities which will allow information to flow more effectively. So that's number 2. Number 3. Exaptation. We need to map knowledge at the right level of granularity so we can repurpose it quickly. When the crisis hits, you haven't got time to invent things from scratch. One of the big things we've done in a 4-year program to create a complexity-based alternative to design thinking is to find ways in which we can map unarticulated needs to existing IT capabilities in clusters. Because if you can use what you've already developed to do something which the users didn't know they wanted yet, you become strategic rather than just somebody who does what executives ask you to do. And that need for IT to become strategic is actually quite important. So that's number 3. All of these are written up with documentations. Yeah, you can follow it up. We have an open source wiki, kinevin.io, which everybody's welcome to. Fourthly, this is map the constraints. So I'm not going to go into this. This is something we're now running whole day courses on. Constraints can be managed in a complex adaptive system. Once we've mapped them, we put them on an energy, a time to change grid. And that allows us to define what isn't going to change and define the strategic scope for operation. So rather than say, it would be nice if we got over here, we say, where the hell are we and what can we change? In complexity, you map the present rather than defining the future, and you start journeys with a sense of direction rather than having specific goals. You can look up this in more detail. We're running training courses now, but that's actually a key aspect, because you can manage that. And finally, you need to build human sensor networks. You need to use the whole of your workforce to do real-time decision support, because you've got to find the 17%. So I want to finish. More or less. I'm going to be exactly on time, I think, if I do this right. Yeah. This is actually the result of a mass employee consultation. So what we've done is we've described the situation as we currently understand it. We presented it to the whole workforce, and they have to interpret it within a half-hour period so there can be no consultation. Now, this means Gaussian distributions apply for the statisticians. If every agent is independent of every other agent, you get reliable results. The minute the agents connect, you hit a Pareto distribution. Yeah? And we use high abstraction metadata, which we developed and patented years ago. So what this shows, we presented the situation, and people have described what they think about the situation. And as you can see in this map, in effect, what we've got is 1, 2, 3, 4 opinions, and these are kind of like grouped. So that means I've got 4 completely different perspectives. Well, 3 completely different perspectives and 1 minor variation. This is hugely influential if you're a CEO. You haven't got time to commission research. You presented the problem to a diverse group of people. You can now see them differently. And at any point, I can click on this and I can read their explanations about why they placed it there. So I've actually got narrative explanation with statistical balance. This is a 17%. So this is where we're now starting to move, and IT is in a really good position to do this, because along with HR, you're one of the only 2 departments which span everybody. So the ability to provide decision support using existing technology to executives is key, because we need to shift into this real-time decision-making. Remember I talked about the magnets? I can pulse this out every week and see if I get changes. We actually use this to measure the impact of Agile on users by presenting stories from the Agile community to the users and seeing how they interpret them, see minority-majority views, and we see how these change over time. It's actually an ungameable way of managing the process. So what I try to do is to go through the field guide, go through some of the principles behind it, and really, I want to finish with three quick slides. One is the whole issue about manage. There's nothing wrong with management. On the bottom left is my mother's book, which she was given by my grandfather. It's called Mrs. Beaton's Book of Household Management. I think he was convinced she wouldn't be able to look after his son. So he gave her this massive, it's hysterical if you want to read it. It tells you how to manage servants. I mean, my mother was born above a whorehouse in Cardiff Docks. The idea she would ever manage servants was, what the hell's going on here? But it's a very funny book, but it lays down rules for everything. There is no uncertainty left whatsoever. No? And that's actually what management means in the French interpretation of the word, which is household management. But the Italian origin is the ability to ride a horse. And that's the White Horse of Uffington. That's actually a Neolithic carving on a hill near where I live. It captures the essence of what a horse is. I mean, it's a beautiful bit of art, yeah, in terms of the way it works. So we need to think about, are we managing a horse or are we managing a household budget? If the system is ordered and predictable, we can control it in the way we all know how to control it. If it's not ordered and predictable, we can still measure things, but we can't measure outcome. We have to measure vectors. Are we going in the right speed, at the right, the right direction, with the right consumption of energy? And that's a more effective targeting. So, final point. The first time I ever saw SAFE was in Novi Sad, so I have really bad associations with Novi Sad as a result. I wrote a blog post called The Infantilization of Management. And one of the reasons I said SAFE would never work is this. You don't scale a complex adaptive system by aggregation or imitation. You scale it by decomposition and recombination. If anybody's interested, we're actually working with other people in the Agile community to launch a whole new approach which decomposes every Agile method from every vendor into its lowest coherent part, so that you can then put them together in different combinations. You can peel out a sprint from Scrum and replace it with a three-month time box from DSDM, all those sort of combinations. But it needs to be open source, and it needs to be this type of approach. Decompose and recombine. Keep thinking about that in software development. You scale by decomposition and recombination, not by aggregation and imitation. And again, that comes back into the object orientation. And the final message from Gaping Void, just to leave you with this, it's a key lesson, right? I can tell you how to fail, but the pathways to success will always be different. And that requires you to be open to the possibilities and opportunities provided by complexity and by the ability of human beings to handle abstraction and uncertainty if they're given the space to do it. Thank you very much for your time.